Hi everyone, I hope you guys are all well. It's rather wet in South of England at the moment, as you can probably tell from my hair. But that's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm here to talk about what's happening today. Today is International Women's Day. I've not done a video relating to International Women's Day before, so I thought, why not? I want to do something. I want to talk about some of the women who I love from history, from literature, and music and such, who I just love for all different reasons, and just ha open up a discussion about it. So I'd love it in comments and such, if you want to let me know about the women and such that are on my collection of stuff I've got here on my sofa, or let me know the women who you admire. I think that'd be absolutely awesome. Now, one of the women is that is on my list. Unfortunately, I don't have anything to refer to hold up and show you. So I'm just going to talk about her now here, and that is Matilda, not the Matilda of Roald Dahl. I'm talking about Empress Matilda. She was the daughter of Henry I and the mother of Henry II of England from the 1100s and back in medieval times. She was a woman who, when her father died in the 1135, she was his only child. So he was like, oh, cool. I'm going to get the throne. I'm the first girl to get the throne. Whoa. And her cousin Stephen went, no, you're not. You're a girl. You don't get to have the throne. And took the throne from her. She was in France at this time because she just got married. And when she heard the news about her father's death, and quite frankly, she was pissed off about this. So she went, no. That you're not taking that throne away from me. And she went out and basically went to war with her cousin. So whenever I see like gifts of people like oh hell no kind of thing, or that boldness of character and such, I always think of Matilda. I think she was an extraordinary woman. How she fought against her cousin Stephen for the right to the throne. She physically she fought in battles with him, captured him. There was a whole negotiation thing with Stephen's wife, who is actually also called Matilda. So it is, when you're reading about her or anything, it can be quite odd because you've got the two Matildas flying about. But you know, it is what it is. Matilda was a very popular name at that time. So negotiating with that Matilda, Stephen's wife, because Stephen's wife had captured Matilda's half brother, and there was a whole swapping thing. Her son Henry II, when he was 14, he went into battle with him. There was a whole thing of Matilda. She got captured. She got thrown in prison. She faked her own death. She held her breath, faked her own death, got shoved into a coffin, and literally thrown out of the prison, busted out of the coffin, ran away, and then went to war again. So she literally came back from the dead in order, in Stephen's eyes, to get the throne. I mean, how badass is that? That's just amazing. Sadly, though, she didn't get the throne back to as her own. She got it for her son instead, because by the time, as time went on, Stephen was getting older. Sadly, his wife Matilda died, and then his son died. He had no heir. He had no way of building this great dynasty under his name. And the next living relative, to pass it on to, male relative, was Matilda's son Henry. So the crown went to Henry. Matilda's son instead. So she never did get the throne, but my God, she fought for it. And to me, she won, even if, because of all the stuff that she did, to get the throne for her son and everything, all the badass things she did. She is just pure determination, heart, motherly. She's just wonderful. I adore Matilda. I think she's a great, great woman of our time. Now, of our history, should I say. Now, when it comes to books and such, there's not many. There is one. I had a book called She Wolves, which was a collection of women throughout history before Elizabeth I, who basically kind of stood up for themselves, did that and the other. I had a copy and I can't find it. So, I can't remember. I either borrowed it from the library, quite possibly, and so I've given it back, or I've gotten rid of it in a clear out. And if I've done that, I'm really gutted because I really quite like to read it again. But if you're able to find it, She Wolves is a really, really good book. What I'll do, because I can't remember the name of the author, I'll put the link to it in, on Amazon or something in the description, so that way, if you do want to look into it, you can find it there. Okay, so that's number one, Empress Matilda. Now, from one Matilda to another. But it's a character from the book Matilda by Roald Dahl, but not Matilda herself. The second person on my list is Miss Honey. Miss Honey is Matilda's teacher in Roald Dahl's Matilda. She is a woman who is quite quiet. She's loving. She has quite a past. A horrific past, but what I adored about her ever since I was a child, well, a few things. One, she never let her past define her. Ever. And two, she really prided herself on the things that she was able to do for herself as an independent woman. She went out, she got her little house. Okay, it's not the grandest of places, and the walls are whitewashed and everything, but it's her house, and she's so proud of it. And I distinctly remember reading Matilda for the first time, and the motion of Matilda looking, well, she's looking around the house, and she's like, oh my God. And there's this description where she rubs her wrist on the wall and looks at her wrist, and her, and it's white because it's whitewashed, it's come off on her on her wrist. And I distinctly remember that. And Miss Honey also showed me, not that I ever questioned it, but it really showed me how important teachers are and how you can trust them with anything. I think it's a really, Matilda is not just a great classic book for the story and everything. The things that it teaches young children are fantastic. And Miss Honey, she taught me a lot. And I love how she keeps herself to herself. She's not a show-offy person. She adores her job. She adores the people she works with, apart from Miss Trunchbull, of course. Yeah. She adores the children. She epitomizes warmth and kindness and loyalty, and she's so trustworthy and she's so proud of the things in her life. And it's not much. But it's hers and it's wonderful. So she taught me a lot when I was younger, and still to this day, whenever I think of Matilda, I think of Miss Honey, and she makes me smile. The thing that also radiates from her is this relationship with her father that was so close, that was so beautiful, and tragically it was cut short when she was very young. But as I said, she hasn't let that define her. And I just can't help but I kind of imagined, or ever since I was a child, that whenever she thinks back and over her childhood, yes, she had the horrific stuff that happened with her father's death and what happened with her aunt and such. But whenever I think of her childhood, I think of the warmth of her hugs from her father, and I think that is the kind of things that she has grown up into adulthood focusing on, not letting the bad corrupt her, and having the warmth to share the joy that she had, even though it was very limited, with the world, with her students, and Fair play to you, Miss Honey. I love you. I absolutely love you. So, that's two. I forgot to say there's like 10 on my list. So, let's move on to number three. And number three is a woman who I adore because she makes me laugh so much, and that is Victoria Wood. Victoria passed away, I think 2, maybe 3 years ago now, and it's very, very rare that a celebrity's death gets to me. Very rare. And I cried. I really cried when Victoria Wood died. I remember my mum called me at work. It was late afternoon, not long before I was going to leave the office, and she rang me crying. And I was like, "Oh my God, mum, are you okay? What's going on?" And she told me, and it completely took me aback. And I left work shortly after, and I cried all the way home on the bus. And I came home, and I went through my DVD collection of Victoria. I was just watching them one after the other over a couple of days, because she passed away from cancer. She didn't announce that she was ill or anything, so it was a complete shock that this happened. But keeping an illness private when you're a celebrity, you're totally entitled to, just as everyone is entitled to. But it was a real hard blow. And Victoria Wood was so wonderful because she has this amazing ability to make you laugh, not just laugh, gut laugh, like really. She was able to, kind of like Peter Kay, look at people in Britain and various things that we do and talk about them. But with her jokes, she could make you laugh your head off and then cry the next moment if with her extraordinary writing. She made these absolutely amazing songs. I adored her songs over the years, and her Christmas specials were so wonderful to watch each year and still are wonderful to watch. One of her best things that she ever did was Dinner Ladies. There was two series about a group of people who run a canteen in a warehouse, and it was just in factories out, and it was just absolutely extraordinary. It looks at Britain, it looks at who we are, and everything, and just displays, just as she always displayed, the absolute joys and wonders and quirks about our society and who and individuals, but full of heart and full of grace and full of just wonderfulness. And I feel that, listening to watching interviews and such with her over the years, that was who she was. She wasn't somebody who, when you look at various other like comedians and such, that she did the stand-up stuff and then went on into various other writings, such as Dinner Ladies and doing her Christmas specials and skits and all that lot. And she's had a lot of career with Julie Walters and everything. But I kind of feel like comedians nowadays, they're very rare that you find them, they're able to do these kind of things, because they're either just do stand-up or they just do comedy TV show, kind of like Gavin and Stacey, or that kind of comedy TV show. But it's very rare that you get people that can flow really in and out of the other, and everything they do is absolutely wonderful and amazing. And one of those people is Miranda Hart. I adore Miranda Hart. She's fantastic. That I feel like Victoria Wood kind of paved the way for her to have that similar-esque comic ability, that thing of we're totally open. We have responded to Victoria Wood and said, "Look, we are totally open to have these kind of things." And Miranda Hart went, "Well, I'm going to have a go at this," and she kicked ass with her show, Miranda. So I think Victoria Wood was just this wonderful, gracious woman, and she was also very open about her personal life. She spoke about it a lot in her stand-up routines and various shows. And I loved also the fact that she talked about how she had an eating disorder. She made jokes about it. She had issue with overeating and such, and having a body dysmorphia. Let's say I couldn't think what the condition was. But she very much was open about it, and she made jokes like saying, "It's actually a pretty good disorder to have," she said, because if you compare the price of like coke a bag of cocaine or a bottle of vodka and a bottle of vodka to the price of white loaf bread and a pot of jam, money wise, you can see what which one's more beneficial for you, something like that. It's just, it makes me laugh now. So she was so open, she was so warm, she was so welcoming, and she completely connected with everyone, with the public, with people who she worked with. She sounded like she was just such a wonderful person to work with, to be around, and she totally and utterly adored everything that she did, whether it was dramatic or whether it was funny. Or anything. So I strongly recommend any one of Victoria Wood's DVDs and such, her stand-up shows, her Christmas specials. Go for it. You're in for a treat if you haven't come across her before. Or if you have come across her before, no matter how many times I watch these DVDs, I know them pretty much word for word off by heart. They still make me laugh like crazy. So Victoria Wood, I adore you. Now, on to the next one, number four. And this one's a bit of a dark one, but it is what it is. It's someone from fiction. And that is Seeley from The Colour Purple. The Colour Purple is a fictional book by Alice Walker, and it follows a girl called Seeley who is separated from her sister in like the 1920s, kind of. Oh no, 1910. Sorry, she's separated, and it goes on to the 20s and so on in her life. She's forced to marry this horrible man because of a situation with her sister not being available to marry him because her dad doesn't want her to, kind of thing. And she goes through this absolutely extraordinary life, and it's extraordinary hardships. It's there's She doesn't have the nicest of lives at all. She goes through some true horrors, but I adore her for her beauty. She there's this amazing sequence where her husband, who she refers to as Mister, is ripping her apart basically and saying the most god-awful things possible at I think it's Easter, and she says, I may be black, I may be ugly, I may be old, I may be this, that, and the other, but I am here right now. I am valid. I deserve respect. I deserve love, and you are not going to stop me. She stands up for herself after like 10 plus years of being in this hellish, hellish marriage, and put herself in a powerful position. No, nobody, has to convince her to go there. She It's taken a long time. She has been worn down and worn down and worn down. And in this appointment, she goes, "You know what? Fuck you. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not having that anymore." And she stands up for herself. And I think that's a really important thing. That's a really But that you can it can be that, when you see that, like, for example, I've seen today press, talking about women who have changed science and stuff like this, which is absolutely amazing. And then there are women who, like Oprah Winfrey and Maya Angelou and all of these massive names in the world, who are also brilliant, extraordinary, fabulous, go on, good for you. But then at the same time, you can't have somebody who is a complete unknown, who do that thing of just going, wait, hang on one moment. That could be a massive step, a massive bit of courage to do that. And they did that. And they should be really praised for having done that. I was quite a very introverted person, very quiet, wouldn't say boo to the goose. And then as I got older, I kind of felt, you know, a bit more itching to say something, but I would stop myself. I wouldn't allow people to hear my voice. And then when I turned about 30, I was like, you know what? I'm not going to stand for this anymore. And I said what I wanted to say. And I've carried on that kind of momentum. Sometimes I have kept a bit more quiet, but I'm like, no, I'm sick of this. I'm standing up for myself. So I can kind of relate to Seeley in that thing of having the courage to take a step forward when, and with her, obviously it's much, much darker. It's, she has been literally hit and punched to the floor multiple times, and which I've never experienced in my life, and you know, touch wood, that never will happen, so it's not to the same degree. But as somebody who is very introverted, who never would have thought of taking a step forward, it might seem tiny to someone else, it's massive for me, it's massive for Seeley. And so to have somebody in literature who does that kind of similar thing, who I love for her graciousness, her beauty, beautiful heart, her soul, it means a lot, and Seeley is really important to me. So Seeley is number 4. And then onto number 5, so we're reaching the halfway point. It's somebody who you might go, huh, okay, but I think she's amazing, and it's Judy Garland. This biography by Gerald Clark, by the way, Get Happy, awesome book, check it out if you're a fan of Judy, or if you're not a fan of Judy and want to learn more about her, it's awesome. Yeah, people probably might go, huh, because, well, she was the movie star who became a drug addict and basically, you know, lost all her money and ended up overdosing. Why should she be celebrated? I've had people actually kind of remark that to me before, and it's like, well, hang on, just because she had flaws doesn't mean that we should completely discard her. Because the amount of people, amount of stories, you know, absolutely amazing stories that you've seen throughout our history, throughout you know, various celebrities and such, there are some who had really, really dark elements to their life, and some who have passed away, like Judy, who passed away in really tragic circumstances, but you still celebrate them. So why not celebrate Judy? What is up with that? So I have loved Judy Garland since I was little, because at my grandparents' house, there was only a couple of videos that we were allowed to watch out their entire video collection that my nan and granddad had. There was only two videos that we were allowed to watch, and that was Seven by Seven Brothers and Gone with the Wind. Judy wasn't in Seven by Seven Brothers, but that sparked my love for MGM and musicals. And I started like going through loads of them, and I stumbled across Judy via The Wizard of Oz. I think it must have been on like Christmas or Easter or something, and watched it. And I absolutely fell in love with her. I thought she was amazing. And I've watched various films of her from throughout of her career. One of my absolute favourites is Meet Me in St. Louis. That was one of my grandmother's favourite films as well. And I adore her in that film. She's absolutely extraordinary. And Vincent Minnelli, who directed it, who became one of her husbands, because she had quite a few, he frames her so beautifully throughout that film. Literally, in like window frame, she's just blossoms in the shots, and the colours that he mixes in to accentuate her beauty is just gorgeous. But with Judy, I feel that she epitomizes for me a strength that's very different to the strength of, say, Matilda, who we spoke of before, with her determination to get the throne and everything. Judy went through a lot in her, from her childhood onwards throughout her whole life, and prominently was with drugs, because her mother kind of set her off early on drugs, because she would be given pills to wake up, pills to go to sleep. She'd be put on pills to give her energy. Then when she got a contract at the MGM, she got put on pills to make her diet, and all of those again, pills to suppress her appetite. She was just constantly on drugs, basically. And so she was pushed and pulled around. She was basically an object to MGM. She wasn't a person, she was an object who had to do XYZ. And MGM were very particularly hard. I mean, when at one point she had a bit of a nervous breakdown, and she got put in hospital for quite some time, and she got therapy and such, and the doctors went, okay, she's better now. She has to have a year off to get better. MGM would not do that because of her contract. She got 6 weeks off, and she had to lose. She gained weight while she was in hospital because obviously they need to get her back to strength. And they put her on pills straight away. Lose the weight. She got 6 weeks to get back into, this figure. Go. You will be back in 6 weeks and be ready for camera. It was like that. So she got pushed and pulled around in every possible direction, but she carried on. She had massive flaws, don't get me wrong. But she is, she makes me smile. She makes me sad as well, thinking of all the struggles she went to. But she was determined. She didn't let them stop her. And how she was so like, if you watch the footage from her concert, she was absolutely extraordinary voice. But also, she was very she's always reaching out to her audience. She's always touching them. She's always wanting to interact with them. She was very, very open to people. And I love that quality about her. She was an extraordinary woman, and Gerald Clarke paints her beautifully in this, and he doesn't ignore her flaws in the slightest. She's just wonderful. That picture does make me sad because of the truth of that hat's what that hat was covering in more ways than one. But I just think of her as with joy, and I hope she, in her her death, she found the rainbow for her to go over, because Over the Rainbow really epitomized her career, and also her as a person, I think. And that, the line at the end, if happy little bluebirds fly beyond the rainbow, why can't I? That really, you really feel it when she sings it in her concerts, that she means it. And I hope she found her rainbow in her death, and she's in a better place. So I love Judy. I think she was extraordinary woman. She should be celebrated for who she was, what she represented, what she went through, and her love and determination to carry on, to keep going. Yeah, she's amazing. Okay, so now we're on to this side of the sofa. So on to is number six now, is it? Yes, number six. And it's a girl who appears in a trilogy that I love. She appears in the Lord of the Rings trilogy. It's Eowyn. She first appears in the second book, but she's also in the third as well. Eowyn is such a strong, strong woman. She lives with her brother and her uncle, and her the because of her uncle Théoden and how he's being corrupted and everything. There's this whole when you first meet her, she has there's lots of fighting in issues with her uncle and her brother, which when Wormtongue gets sent away, that all gets cleared up. But basically, she shows her strength. I have said strength quite a lot through this, but this I always felt that Eowyn really was a representation of Tolkien's wife. I always have had that in my mind. Okay, she's there are other characters who have been referred to as being Tolkien's wife, but for me, it's Eowyn. Her strength, her determination, her loyalty to both in the case of Eowyn to her brother and to her uncle. She kicks ass. She really does. I mean, the fact that there is this character who is said can't be defeated by man. She is disguised as a man and fighting him, and he's like, "Oh, no man can kill me." And she's got this full helmet on that's covering her face, and she whips off her helmet to reveal her face. Goes, "I am no man," and then just completely takes him out. It's like. Girl, I mean, my God, the representation of a woman fighting on a battlefield in a fantasy world, and she doesn't even let the threat of this character, who is so evil, can snap her neck in like a twig, but she goes, I'm not a man, dude. I'm gonna kick your ass," and completely destroys him. Good on you, girl. I love her. Her strength is just extraordinary. All of these women are so strong, but they have, in their various different ways. And Eowyn, she does have a bit of well, it's not a flaw, but it kind of is a bit of a flaw where she kind of throws herself at Aragorn, sort of thing. Because he's the first man that she's encountered who who is kind of her equal. He is bold, he's strong, he's funny, he's determined. She sees all of these qualities within him. That she sees in herself, so no wonder she falls for him. But Aragorn even says it himself that she has a strength that is otherworldly, and I adore her for that. She doesn't let anything get her down, apart from maybe Aragorn rejecting her. But she very quickly moves on. but I love that in especially in a fantasy series, you've got a woman who is fighting on the battlefield, who disguises herself as a man in order to get the equality to be able to fight for the land that she loves and fight for her people. You don't get that often in fantasy stuff because it tends to be the kind of like Arwen or something who is also in Lord of the Rings, or Galadriel, where they're these wonderful figures, but they're very much stay in safety. Eowyn is not like that. She wants to be in danger. She wants to do everything physically possible to help her people, and she will do it without even thinking. And that is fantastic. Love her. Love, love, love her. Okay, so I'm moving on to a couple of characters who appear in the Harry Potter books, of course, because I love Harry Potter. So the next two spaces go to these are the books that they first appear in, Hermione Granger and Luna Lovegood. Now, Hermione, it kind of feels like, obviously, I came to Harry Potter. Not as a child, in my late teens, early 20s was when I came to Harry Potter, and I feel very much feel felt like when I first, probably read it, as well as still feel like to this day, that Hermione is kind of like the next generation Belle, and really they're both played by Emma Watson in films versions. In what I mean by that is that you have this girl who celebrates reading. She is somebody who is extremely warm. She absolutely accepts everyone for who they are in in who she encounters. Okay, she can be a bit show-offy. I will give Hermione that, but without Hermione, literally Harry and Ron would be dead straight away in the first book because they wouldn't know diddly squat about what to do, what the rules are. The rules at Hogwarts, so who people are, nothing without Hermione. So, they owe Hermione a lot. How, as I said, she's accepting of everyone. She adores reading. She celebrates that. She is so warm and motherly, and she makes a kick-ass mum. She will. Well, she did, should I say? Because obviously, in the epilogue, we meet her kids, and such. And yet, she will stand up for everyone. I mean, look at her standing up for to Draco and such. Even though in the first, couple of books, she does let words get to her, but then she's like, oh hell no, I'm gonna, deal with that crap. I'm gonna say what I think. She is so smart, and I think kids need to have that knowledge that they can be smart, they can be loving, they can accept everyone for who they are and not be put down for that. Because there is, a lot of stigma that, it's like, oh, it's very nerdy, isn't it, if you read books and all that lot. But it's becoming more and more open in our society that's not really, the case. That it's totally acceptable to have that label, whereas previously, like especially in like my generation, it was seen as a very negative thing. Some people, it's still to this day, where people feel that nerd is very derogative term, that and everything. But to me, I celebrate it. I'm a nerd. I love it. I absolutely love that, having that label. And yeah, Hermione, she is badass, she is strong, she is so smart and loyal and helpful and charming, and I love her. I love her. But the girl that goes head to head with her is Luna Lovegood, who was introduced in the fifth book. I adore Luna because she is so quirky. She absolutely knows who she is and doesn't give a crap what anybody else thinks of her. She it's very, as J.K. Rowling said when she's spoken about Luna, it's very rare that you meet someone in your life who is like that, who can honest to God say, this is who I am, I don't give a crap what you think, I'm gonna be me, I'm gonna celebrate me, and you can just stay over there if you have a problem with it. And I think Harry needs that, throughout his time at Hogwarts and everything. And it's really refreshing when Luna kind of turns up, because she was able to say things and point out things to Harry that he's not even thought of before, and it makes him smile and gives him a new perspective on situations. Because she's so wonderful that she's able to do that. She's very blunt as well when it comes to stuff. She doesn't mince her words. And I feel her. I in my soul. I feel like I am a Luna. I might not necessarily say it out loud like she does. But as I said, since I turned like 30 and developed this new confidence, having taken a step when previously I wouldn't have done, I think, a bit more like Luna. I've expressed myself more. I've been more open about who I am, about the way that I feel about things, and so thus I have a connection to Luna in my heart and my soul. I absolutely love her. Right, my voice is starting to go, and I've got two left. So let's try and get these done as quick as I can. So the next one actually covers three women. They're three sisters. They're three sisters I adore. If you know me or you watched any of my videos, you know who I'm about to say. It's the Bronte sisters. I have loved the Bronte sisters for a very long time. I adored Emily Bronte's Wuthering Heights since I was about 15. I've loved it, but my sister loved Jane Eyre, and I couldn't stand Jane until like a year, or maybe it's 2 years ago now. Or is it? No, I think it was last year. I read Jane Eyre properly for the first time, and my God, I fell head over heels in love with it, which then led me to Ten at Wildfell Hall, and oh my God, I absolutely fell in love with it. So I have read all three of the sisters, as it were, in the past year or so, and I am in awe. I always have been in awe of them, but I am more in awe of them now, because it is that thing that they said that Jane Austen may write amazing romances, you know, this lot of Georgian life, we write the truth. And it is so true. They went through quite a lot, losing siblings, losing parents, losing their brother, losing each other, as Emily and Anne died before Charlotte did. But they, especially Emily, has this supernatural strength, which, like Eowyn from, you know, the Lord of the Rings, but they all had their own personalities. They all had their own thoughts and feelings about each other, about the world, about their family, but they're always there for each other. And this drama, To Walk Invisible, is absolutely fabulous, extraordinary. Please watch it if you haven't watched it, to explore the life of the Bronte sisters, and know what they were like. Three very different women, three wonderful women, all three of them determined to make something for themselves, because they knew that with their brother having his addiction issues and debts, they couldn't, they had their father, who was a vicar, but he was obviously poor and everything. They didn't have opportunities, so they went, right, we've got to stand up and do something for ourselves. And they did that with their writing. And they were absolutely extraordinary women. And I adore all three of them. They're extraordinary. And to finish my list, I've looked to a set of women who history has looked on them in a very strange way. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad, sometimes it's really ugly. And they are the wives of Henry VIII. I've got a couple of books on them and a couple of DVDs, these documentaries, which I really strongly recommend. So the, you know, the Catherines, the Annes, and the Jane. So when each of these six women were completely different. They had their own things, a set of things that they loved, things that they hated, different qualities, different styles, different ages, different times in which they were brought up in. That sounds strange, but what I mean by that is obviously because with his second wife, Anne Boleyn, Henry broke with the Catholic Church, which set up the Church of England, and that completely caused a shift in England in the way in which it viewed religion and how society changed and such. So it felt like when that happened, it England shifted into like this new era kind of thing. So that's what I meant by different times, because the two different ways in which England kind of viewed religion and everything else. But all of them had a it's almost like an attraction to the flame, of Henry, they all share these different. They all share kind of qualities, but ever so slightly different. So, in regards to, let's say, for example, boldness. Let's take boldness for example. So, Anne Boleyn was very, very bold. To do with how she felt about things, and Henry knocked her down for it on multiple occasions, and it eventually caused her to have her head cut off. Whereas Jane, the wife who followed Henry, followed Anne, into Henry's life, she was much quieter. She wasn't as bold, but instead, she because there was a whole thing about how Anne's daughter. Elizabeth and his first wife's daughter Mary were declared bastards, and she wanted to get them to have a relationship with their father again. So she wasn't she with boldness. She didn't like just go, "Oh my God, Henry, we're gonna do this." La 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 la. She would talk about it over, and she would gently chip away, chip away, chip away, chip away until she got what she hoped for, and it made them be able to have a relationship from that point on. So they all share, you know, strength, boldness, determination, all that kind of stuff, but in slightly different ways. And I think they all should be celebrated for the fact that they became his. They married Henry because obviously he was notorious for things that he did to his various wives, you know, executions, divorce, etc. But they didn't let that stop them. You know, love also is a key part to play in their how they felt about Henry. But all six of them, I admire as individuals, I admire them as a group. I think they should really be focused and celebrated for who they were as people. Lucy Worsley's documentary looks at them as individuals, not the, oh, Anne was the, like, say, for example, so the first wife, Catherine, oh, she was the one who was, you know, very, very religious and very angry all the time. Anne Boleyn was the, you know, the cheater, the one who was basically a tart. Jane, she was the angelic one who couldn't do anything wrong, and you know, she very much kept herself to herself and did everything that her husband told her. And the other, you know, the other wives as well, how Anne, she was the ugly one. She was just disgusting. She was a horrible person. Then Catherine, the young slut, and final Catherine, who survived her husband. She was the nurse basically, but they were complete women in their own separate right. And Lucy looks at each of them individually and does a beautiful job of depicting who they were. And Channel 5 in the same year did a documentary on Henry VIII and his six wives. This looks more, I suppose, from a factual point of view in regards to the timeline of events in Henry VIII's lives, and does look at the women individually, but I prefer Lucy Worsley's look at them. But they're both really great documentaries. So I can't hold everything up because I've got like two rows of books and such on my sofa here. But yeah, so we've had Empress Matilda, Miss Honey, Seeley, Judy Garland, Victoria Wood, Hermione Granger, the wise Henry VIII, Luna Lovegood, Eowyn, and the Bronte sisters. They are just some of the women who I absolutely adore throughout history, throughout music, throughout literature. Yeah, these are only a few, and I just wanted to share them with you. And that's all I can think of to say. I know I've probably repeated myself a few times by you saying how strong they were and determined they were, but they truly, truly were, and that they should be celebrated for all of their different qualities, all of their good points, their bad points, all the things that they did and didn't do, and that how wonderful people they were. That's all I can think of to say. So, have you got any women you want to celebrate here on International Women's Day? Please give me a comment in the comments box below. As I said, I'll put the link to the She-Wolves book in the description and any other links to things that you might enjoy about these various people. And I'd love to open up discussions with you guys also about any more expanding on these great women and any other women that you want to mention who you like. Let's open the discussion. And yeah, I will be back with another video as soon as I can. All right, guys. Bye.